Welcome to EBG Pathshala. Today, we'll be talking about reading new literatures in English, and the name of the module is Indian Diasporic Literature and Politics of Representation. I am Shashwati Shaha, Assistant Professor, Department of English, Sikkim University. The content of the module has been written by me. In this module, we'll be talking about what is diaspora and why do we need to read Indian diaspora in particular. We'll also talk about how the concept of home, exile, location, dislocation, memory, and all of this gets represented in the works of the Indian diasporic writers. And lastly, we'll also talk about how the reading and consuming of Indian diasporic literature largely depends on how it gets represented and presented by the government politics and popular mass media, including Bollywood. Let us begin. Diaspora refers to a scattered population whose origin lies within a small geographical locale. Diaspora can also refer to the movement of the population from its original homeland. It has come to refer particularly to historical mass dispersion of an involuntary nature, which means that a group of people are forced to move out of their country of origin for one or multiple reasons. According to Robin Cohen, diasporas exhibit several of the following features. Number one, dispersal from an original homeland, often traumatically. Number two, alternatively, the expansion from a homeland in search of work, in pursuit of trade, or to further colonial ambitions. Number three, a collective memory and myth about the homeland. Number four, an idealization of the supposed ancestral home. Number five, a return movement. A strong ethnic group consciousness sustained over a long time is number six. Number seven, a troubled relationship with host societies. Number eight, a sense of solidarity with co-ethnic members in other countries. And nine, the possibility of a distinct, creative, enriching life in tolerant host countries. Writers of Indian diaspora have enjoyed the center stage in emerging new literature, chiefly because of the theoretical formulation being generated by their works. The language and way of writing are transformed when they come in contact with the other culture or try to assimilate with the new culture. These writers are often preoccupied with the elements of nostalgia as they seek to locate themselves in new cultures. They write in relation with the culture of their homeland and at the same time adapt and negotiate with the culture space of the host land. Generally, diasporic literature deals with alienation, displacement, existential rootlessness, nostalgia, quest of identity, and other issues. This also addresses issues related to amalgamation or disintegration of culture. It reflects the immigrant experience that comes out of the immigrant settlement. Uma Parameswaran has defined it as follows. First is one of nostalgia for the homeland left behind, mingled with fear in a strange land. The second is a phase in which one is busy adjusting to the new environment, that there is a little creative output. The third phase is shaping of diaspora existence by involving themselves with ethnocultural issues. The fourth is when they have arrived and start participating in the larger world politics and national issues. The Indian diasporic population is of particular importance is because of the fact that India had experienced migration and as a result of which like diasporic settlements all across the world right from a very early period. Indian diasporic settlements or migration from India can be traced back to as early as pre-colonial times when people moved to mainly Southeast Asia region in search of trade and to propagate religion. In the colonial period, we have a very huge history of indentured labor being transported to plantation colonies in various parts of the world by the British rulers. In the present times, we also see a lot of migration happening from India is because of the fact that people try to go abroad to find a better life, better job, and with a lot of dream in their eyes, they go and settle in a land which is unknown to them, but that does not mean that they forget their home. So largely the kind of creative output that comes out of this population is talking about the idea of homelessness, their attempt of assimilating with the new culture, their nostalgia of the home that they have left behind, and the kind of exile that they talk about. Mostly, the migrants suffer from the pain of being far off from their homes. The memories of their motherland, the anguish of leaving behind everything familiar, agonizes the mind of the migrants. William Safran has observed that they continue to relate personally or vicariously to the homeland in a way or another, and the ethnic communal consciousness and solidarity are importantly defined by the existence of such a relationship. The diasporic Indians too do not break the relationship with the ancestral land. There is a search for continuity and ancestral impulse, an effort to look for their roots. In their attempt to integrate with the adopted culture while maintaining their inheritance, they develop a dual identity, and their culture becomes a kind of a sandwich culture. Their efforts for assimilation and failure to do so often dishearten them. The feeling of rootlessness, alienation, confusion, nostalgia, dislocation, and suffering due to discrimination on the basis of race, culture, religion, and language concludes into conflicts, fight for identity, and on the other hand, leads to birth of feelings of marginality in a minority group. This results in the creation of fractured identity, and as you can understand, all of this goes into the formation of what we call diasporic literature. Interestingly, the term diaspora, exile, alienation, expatriation are synonymous and possess an ambiguous status of being both a refugee and an ambassador, the two roles being very different. The diasporic writer attempts to do justice to both. As a refugee, he seeks security and protection, and as an ambassador, he projects his own culture and helps enhancing its comprehensibility. Indian diaspora consists of individuals that have their own sense of being Indian and what being Indian means for their lives. This includes how they feel towards other NRIs, in what way they integrate the Indian culture into their lives, whether they feel comfortable living in the Western world or dream of returning to India, whether they appreciate their otherness or try and hide it, and other issues like that. The diasporic writers turn to their homeland for various reasons. For example, Naipaul, who is in a perpetual quest for his root, turns to India for the same. Rushdie visits India to mythologize its history. Mystery, Rohinton Mystery, visits and revisits India for a kind of revitalization and to re-energize his aching soul. Bharati Mukherjee's childhood memories harken her time and again. All the same, it is necessary to realize the importance of cultural encounter, the bicultural pools, which finally helps in the emergence of the new culture. The diasporic writing, also known as the theory of migrancy, helps generate aesthetic evaluation, negotiate with cultural constructs, and aid the emergence of a new hybridity. One of the most important way in which diasporic existence of Indians abroad is represented is through the documentation of their memories. These memories are of the writer's own experiences of his childhood, of his adulthood, if they have migrated after being adults, or are passed on orally to him or her by elders in form of anecdotes and tales. This happens with the second generation migrants. These shared memories in turn gives rise to an image of India in the writer's mind that she or he desires to explore. Therefore, the memories of the home left behind not only haunt the lives of the first generation immigrants, but also leaves an indelible impression on their children. As Vijay Mishra narrates, "I have carried memories of that experience thanks to my late father and mother, my brother Hiday and my sister Shiro. Although removed from that experience, my children Rohan and Paras have not been unaware of their father's working class indenture heritage and have sensitively engaged with it. For our granddaughters Anjali and Tara, diaspora as read here would be a matter of archive fever only. For our daughter-in-law Kylie, it will be a similar matter of understanding another history. Literature's engagement with the phenomenon of Indian diaspora can be categorized into number 1, literature on the diaspora, and number 2, literature of and by the diaspora. This can be attributed to the difference in perspective of an insider as opposed to an outsider. Literature on the Indian diaspora is enriched by the contribution of both diasporic Indian writers and Indians who are intrigued by the Indian diaspora. So which means it will consist of both creative writings like novels, short stories, poems on diaspora, and also it will consist of those sort of non-fictional writings which talks about the diasporic existence of various diasporic authors or diasporic population in general. For a large number of Indian diasporic population, the expression of their aspiration and experience and of their joys and pathos find their way into the creative writing of the diasporics. For others, it ignites a desire to know their history, which results in endeavors leading to academic writings. One such example is Shamsuddin's Solving East Indian Roots in Trinidad, which is published in 1994, which is a result of his urge to trace his roots. Desire led to his journey through the names of almost 1,47,95,254 Indians who were registered as indentured workers in Trinidad between 1845 and 1917. This enterprise helped him to solve ancestors' arrival for at least 200 other people besides himself. For many Indian diasporic writers like Naipaul and Chumpa Lahiri, the home that they represent in their writings is a part of their imaginary past. These groups of writers are usually second generation diasporic population. For each one of them, India bears a different meaning. Their perception of the imaginary homeland and the inclination towards it is largely influenced by their socialization in the formative years. The first generation migrants who left India preserved a photographic image of their home in their minds, because they have spent a considerable amount of time in India, so they know what India is like, the culture, the home, the place. But for the second generation, it is mostly the history told to them by their parents. So they have a secondary sort of memory, not a primary memory. This image hardly changed with time. It is quite obvious that the children initially visualized India through their parents' eyes. Unlike today, when technology helps immigrants stay virtually connected to their homeland, the early diasporics were completely alienated from their home. For those diasporic writers who spend their formative years in India, homeland is not frozen in time. They do not harp much on an imaginary homeland. They were well informed about the existential India. Being part of the diaspora enables them to criticize the flaws in the system. Mystery is one of those diasporic Indian writers who spend time in India helps him to critically analyze the political situation of the country. The home that they represent is a part of their own experience, which helped them to relate to the ones they had seen around themselves. The heterogeneity of the diasporic writers add to the variety in the qualitative representation of home. The ideas evoked in their literature or literary works are generally reflective of their upbringing. Considering the upbringing factor, there are clearly two distinct group of writers. One group had a very privileged upbringing. Chumpa Lahiri can be taken as an example of that group, who were brought up in a kind of luxurious life abroad. The other group has grown up within the limitations of an indentured lineage. Sri Prasad Naipaul, V.S. Naipaul, Shiva Naipaul, and Sam Selvan are few examples of such writers. For the latter, writing was also a mode of vindication. As Patrick French notes, Naipaul's lasting ambition was to beat the English at their own language. It is surely an attempt to break free of the colonial baggage. The variations in these writings problematize the general perception of home. The pain for lost home and roots get represented in the writings of the members of Indian diaspora whose lineage is that of indentured labor. Every account of indentured labor migrations speaks of how they were guiled into leaving their home with a promise of return. There was always a promise that they will go to a better working environment, they will earn a lot of money and return home with the money earned. But that promise never materialized. So they had to settle there. They got stuck in the place to which they went only for earning money. Once landed on the foreign shore, these immigrants realized that they would never see their home again. A sense of exile pervaded their life, and this accounts for the popularity of the Ramayana, an epic of exile per excellence, in the lives of the diasporic Indians settled in the Caribbean islands, Mauritius, Fiji, etc. The literature that has churned out from this new world does not speak only of the pain of displacement in the colonial plantations away from India. It generally speaks of the everyday life of the people in these plantations. As an all-pervading rootlessness, temporariness and instability were characteristics of the Indian diaspora found in the plantations. As Harish Trivedi says, to be once unhomed is to be always and forever unhomed. If by home one understands an apt location in history, community and culture. The literature of the Indian diaspora also represents several dimensions of being unhomed and the attempt on the part of the diasporic Indians to cope with it. Though each member of the Indian diaspora has a very different experience, there are shared emotions that are triggered by being in the diaspora. All diasporas are unhappy. All diasporas are unhappy, but every diaspora is unhappy in its own way. Diasporas refers to people who do not feel comfortable with their non-hyphenated identities as indicated on their passport. Diasporas are people who would want to explore the meaning of the hyphen, but perhaps not press the hyphen too far for fear that this would lead to massive communal schizophrenia. They are precariously lodged within an episteme of real or imagined displacements. Diasporas are both celebrated by late postmodernity and maligned by early modernity. The celebration and the maligning of the Indian diaspora are best found in the literature of or on the diaspora. The sublimity of the Indian diaspora has generated a literary canon that highlights the significance of this phenomena. It speaks of the pain of displacement, both physical and socio-psychological, and a feeling of temporariness. As Pico Iyer recounts in The Man Within My Head, just as when we had first moved to California several years before. None of the words I learned in our ancient classrooms carried, and nothing in post-1960s California made such sense within our grey stone cloisters. It was like flying between different dimensions of the mind. One world could not more understand the other. Therefore, we can see that the diasporic literature is made more appealing by the way it is represented. Many a time, in an attempt to unravel a dormant past, these writers dig up anecdotes of nostalgia and pathos. Peggy Mohan Jahajin is a literary piece that stems out of nostalgia. It vividly recreates the angst of the indentured labor in Trinidad and the journey from being a sojourner to a diasporic. And at that moment, it suddenly came to me, as clear as the sky, that I was never going back, that I would leave and die across the Kalapani, that's black water. And then I turned to face forward and sat looking at the sea, stretching out forever and ever in front of us. And I stifled the panic rising inside me and tried to think. The diasporic writers, through their literary works, bring to the fore their own angst and that of the Indian diaspora at large. These narratives present before the readers a unique record of the Indian diaspora, a record that reveals a glimpse of the old values, practice, and the consistent improvisations and assimilations that gradually penetrate. Most of these writers are first generation or subsequent generation of diasporics. Look from close quarters, there are differences in representation between members of the old Indian diaspora and new Indian diaspora. The variations in the corpus of Indian diaspora can be attributed to different categories of diasporic Indian writers. There's a clear distinction between writers who belong to old Indian diaspora and the new Indian diaspora. The concept of diaspora is concerned with spatial imaginaries and memory and nostalgia for a homeland. We have already talked about it. In other words, it is the contested interplay of place, home, culture and identity through migration and resettlement. However, this definition does not go far enough. Diaspora is also a socio-cultural construction of an identity based on nationalistic sentiments, political affiliations, religion, and a sense of distinctiveness and the belief in a common fate. What we understand by a diasporic identity in a contemporary world is mediated largely by process of migration, mobility, globalization, historical contingency, the media and government. These are processes which transcend national borders and deterritorialize place both ideologically and materially to transform ethnic communities into diasporic communities with complex, distinctly hybridized national identification. It is a transnational phenomena, yet diaspora is distinct from transnationalism. As stated by Chaturvedi, diasporas and their practices produce and inhibit a post-colonial frontier, a statement particularly true of the Indian diaspora as it enters contemporary currents of post-coloniality, globalization, and transnationality. The extent to which Indian diaspora and globalization are intertwined is exposed by the relationship the Indian government has developed with the Indian diaspora. Now, Indian diaspora is one of the largest diaspora. There is almost like 20 million population scattered worldwide. So it forced the government to come up with new laws to deal with this diasporic population, or what we call the NRIs. Since the early 1990s, the Indian government has become increasingly aware of and involved with its diaspora, formalizing its commitment and connection through a series of policies. This can be attributed to the influence globalizing processes have had on communication technologies and time-space compression, which has resulted in greater interconnection between the Indian diaspora and the mother country, reflected subsequently in the institutional relationship between the Indian government and the diaspora. Members of the Indian diaspora have come to be known as non-resident Indians, or the NRIs, or people of Indian origin, or PIO, denoting a transition from years of neglect to officially and formally recognizing the role of NRIs and PIOs in India's development and global engagement. In September 2000, the Indian government founded a high-level commission on the Indian diaspora in addition to creating a ministerial position relating solely to NRI affairs. The Indian government has been motivated by the perception of its diaspora as a source of foreign exchange, investment and entrepreneurial activities, and as a market, putting various policies in place aimed at forging formal economic links with non-resident Indians. State governments have followed suit and also implemented diaspora-specific investment policies. Because diaspora in India is not a homogeneous factor. There are a lot of communities, a lot of regions from which migration happened. So every state government also took initiative to deal with the diasporic population from their particular state. The government initiatives have inadvertently influenced an increasing global form of Indianness, not ontologically rooted in the country's sovereign territory. This is a useful demonstration of how diaspora are a social construction mediated by discourse, with one of the dominant discourses in the Indian diaspora being those circulated by the homeland government. In other words, the unintentional way in which government policy and debates has constructed a notion of Indianness is symbolic of how different meanings are being written into and read out to the term Indian diaspora. Media and communication technologies are integral aspects of globalization. Technological communication, innovation, and the advent of mass media has greatly influenced modern diaspora. Such technology allows for real-time communication in addition to time-space compression, allowing the more frequent communication with the homeland. Therefore, the significance of new technologies in facilitating transnationalism should not be underestimated. Media cultures are helping to sustain the triadic relationship that migrants forge between their countries of birth or ancestry, countries of settlement, and the wider South Asian diaspora. In the case of the Indian diaspora, the media is purported to have had a unifying and positive effect. However, the outcome of a media presence are varied. Poststructuralism espouses that discourses are often revealed to be subjective truths, taken to be universal truth, but in reality embedded within complex social, cultural, political, and economic power relations. The media is an active agent in the construction of a diasporic identity and concomitantly provides diasporic communities with the opportunity to construct alternative and empowering discourses, an opportunity previously unavailable to them. It shall not be an exaggeration to assert that the life world of the diasporic Indians is best showcased through literature and celluloid. Shades of life in the Indian diaspora have been portrayed with broad brush on the celluloid. It is hardly gainsaid that the visual medium reaches out to a larger mass. Cinema has thematized the various pros and cons of transnational locations. As Patricia Uberoi points out, the concerns, anxieties, and moral dilemma of the everyday life of diasporic Indians are condensed on celluloid. The film industry is an active agent in identity creation, and Bondhubhattai is adamant that the Indian diaspora's imagination of India is strongly informed by Bollywood movies and is therefore strongly informed by Hinduism. Bollywood is a mode of production, a way of producing culture within a national and global context that is inextricably linked to the Indian nation-state and the post-colonial economy of liberalization. This statement symbolizes how all aspects common to the diaspora intersect. In other words, Bollywood encapsulates cultural, social, economic, nationalistic, post-colonial, and globalizing processes. Pervading the academic literature on the Bollywood is the word Indianness, which appears to be synonymous with Bollywood. Scholars cite that Bollywood fulfills the desire to see Indianness and Indian achievement in the works of expatriate filmmakers. This has the effect of creating cultural understanding between Indian nationals and the diaspora, important to the maintenance of the transnational tie between the two. Furthermore, the importance of Bollywood as an element in the fostering of linkage between India and the global Indian diaspora is increasingly being recognized and promoted by the Indian government for a variety of motivations connected to the India government's wider exploitation of its diaspora. Therefore, in this module, we have seen how various aspects of diaspora get represented in the diasporic writing, which is also not a homogeneous factor. There are various types of diasporic writings depending on the time the diasporic author left their homeland, also on how their upbringing has affected the kind of writings that came out of their pen. Then we have discussed how the government policies and mass media, especially Bollywood, affects the understanding of what is diaspora and how the NRI population is experiencing their everyday life. This is kind of forging a link between the population which is living or residing in India and the population of India not residing in India. I hope you enjoyed the module. Thank you.